So today's class we are going to discuss about the types of the fourth part of the fourth whorl of the flower, that is gynecium. See, gynecium is the female reproductive part of a flower. Gynecium is also called as pistil. So gynecium or pistil is the female reproductive part of the flower. Gynecium is a collection of carpels, and it is made up of one or more carpels. It can be monocarpellary or multicarpellary. So gynecium is the female reproductive part of the flower. Gynecium is also called as a pistil. It is an essential whorl. So it is made up of carpels. Gynecium is a collection of carpels. The number of carpels in a gynecium might be one or many carpels. So if it is one carpel, we call it as monocarpellary. If they are having many carpels, we call it as multicarpellary. A carpel has three parts: the ovary, style, and stigma. Within the ovary, they have the ovules or megasporangium. So these ovules, in turn, they have, each ovule has an embryo sac. The embryo sac is the female gametophyte. So the ovules are called as megasporangia. So after fertilization, the ovules are going to form the seeds. Ovary is going to form the fruit wall. So remember about this. A carpel has three parts, that is a ovary, a bulge structure called as ovary, which is above the receptacle or thalamus. Then it has a slender stalk, which we call it as the style. And the style ends at the tip with a receptacle organ for the pollen grains, which we call it as stigma. In case of hibiscus, the stigma was pentafit. The shape of the stigma also can vary. It can be bifid stigma, it can be pentafit stigma, or in case of the Apocynaceae member like Vinca rosea. So please watch the video of Vinca rosea also. So Vinca rosea has a dumbbell-shaped stigma. There are different shapes and types of stigma. So that itself is a different topic. So now at present, you remember a carpel has three parts. The bulged ovary above the receptacle, you can notice a slender stalk-like region, which we call it as the style. And the style at the apical part, it has a receptive organ for pollen grains, which we call it as stigma. So now once we study each of them separately, stigma, it is usually at the tip of the style and is the receptive surface for pollen grains. It is the receptive surface for the pollen grains. So the pollen grains falls on the stigma and they germinate. If they are the same species, they are going to germinate. When pollen grain germinates, they produce the pollen tube. So pollen tube enters the style, it enters the ovary, later it enters the ovule. So that we'll be discussing in the sexual reproduction in flowering plants in second year syllabus. At present, you just remember what is a stigma. It is usually present at the tip of the style and is the receptive surface for pollen grains. Then what is a style? An elongated tube that connects ovary to the stigma, we call it as the style. An elongated tube that connects ovary to the stigma, we call it as style. So ovary is the enlarged basal part on which the style arises. So ovary is the enlarged basal part on which the style arises. Okay, so that is one aspect of it that you have to remember. So ovary is the enlarged part on which the style arises. Each ovary has one or more ovules attached to a flat cushion-like structure called as placenta. So each ovary, so here the pink colored labeling, you can see the stalk is there. Each ovary has one or more ovules attached to a fat, flat, cushion-like structure called as placenta. So you can notice this cushion-like structure called as placenta on which the ovules are attached. Okay, that is the description of ovary. It is the enlarged basal part of the carpel and from which the style arises. Each ovary has one or more ovules attached to the flat cushion-like nutritive tissue called as the placenta. So remember about that. So you can also remember the gynecium. So they have polycarpellary pistils, pistils with many carpels. we call it as polycarpellary or multicarpellary pistils. So if they have many carpels, we call it as multicarpellary pistils. So polycarpellary pistils or multicarpellary pistils, it means that pistil with many carpels, we call them as polycarpellary or multicarpellary pistil. So these multicarpellary or polycarpellary pistils are of two types, apocarpus. The carpels are not fused. In apocarpus, the carpels are free. Example, you can notice in case of lotus, rose, you find that the carpels are not fused. And even I told you about the Michaelia champaca or sampige. So if you dissect the perianth, if you remove the tepals, you can see the spirally arranged carpels. So all these carpels are from a single ovary, but they are all free. They are not fused together, okay? So we call that condition where carpels are free, we call them as apocarpus. So we can notice this apocarpus condition in case of lotus. The carpels are not fused, they are free. And you can also notice this, carpels are free even in rose. So the syncarpus, as the name indicates, syn indicates fused. So the carpels are fused. You can notice that in mustard, tomato, the carpels are fused. They have two carpels. So in case of the orange, it is multicarpellary. Each of the lobe, we are eating it as the lobes of orange or the sweet lime. Okay. So the carpels are all fused. It is multicarpellary example also. So if carpels are fused, we call it as syncarpus. We notice the syncarpus condition in case of mustard, tomato, lady's finger, you might have seen that when you take a section of it as a vegetable, the fruit part of it, see, lady's finger is a fruit. The technical term as per scientist, fruit is a fertilized ovary. So even though we call the lady's finger as vegetable, but from scientific definition, it is a fruit. So it's a carpel. So you have five carpels fused together in case of lady's finger. It's a very good example. You might have taken the section of this bindi or the bendekai. So they have five carpels, okay? And they are all fused. So that's a very good example for syncarpus condition where the carpels are fused. Example, mustard, tomato, lady's finger. They're all example of fused carpels. Free carpels you can notice in case of lotus, rose, and champak flowers. Champak flowers is nothing but the sampige uva, what I was talking about, Michaelia champaca. So if you dissect the tepals and notice them, all the carpels are arranged in a spirally manner. Spiral manner, you find the free carpels, okay? The carpels are all free, they are not fused. So we call that condition as apocarpus condition. Now, the next thing that you have to study under placentation. So before going into this placentation, based on the position of ovary, you have three types of gynecium. So the based on the position of ovary. So the flowers are, you know, that classified into three types, epigynous, perigynous, hypogynous. So the first one that we had studied in our previous slides was hypogynous flower. Hypo means below, gynous means gynecium. Below the gynecium, the calyx, corolla, and andrecium arises. So the ovary is superior, and the three whorls of the flower, that is calyx, corolla, and andrecium, are arising from below the ovary. So the ovary is superior in hypogynous flowers. In perigynous flowers, the ovary is semi-inferior or semi-superior in position because the receptacle is half cup shaped and half of the ovary is within this cup shape, remaining half is above. As a result, you find this calyx, corolla, and andrecium arising from in between the ovary. That is the reason the flower is called as perigynous flower and the ovary is called as semi-superior, or you can also call it as semi-inferior ovary. So that also you have to remember under gynecium, semi-superior ovary or semi-inferior ovary. Then in case of the epigynous flower, epi means above, Gynous means gynecium. Above the gynecium, they are going to arise. What is going to arise above the gynecium? Calyx, corolla, and antrium are arising from above the gynecium. So the ovary is present within a cup-shaped receptacle. In case of epigynous flower, the receptacle or thalamus is cup-shaped, and the complete ovary is within this cup-shaped structure. And above you find this the calyx, corolla, and antrium arising. It since they are arising above the ovary is inferior in position. In epigynous flower, the ovary is inferior in position. So that also you have to describe and remember about the gynecium. Okay. The next one is placentation. So what is placentation and types of placentation? They might be asking you for 2 marks question. So placentation is the arrangement of ovules on the placenta within the ovary. So placentation is the arrangement of ovules on the placenta within the ovary. So we call that as placentation. So the arrangement of ovules on the placenta within the ovary, we call it as placentation. So the different types of placentation are marginal placentation, which you can notice here the first slide. So the ovules are attached to the ovary at the margins through the placenta. So we call it as marginal placentation. In beans family, Fabaceae, you will notice this marginal placentation. Axile placentation, I always give a very good example for axile placentation, I would consider as the lady's finger. So whenever you have taken the section, you find that it is pentacarpillary, and at the center, the septum of this pentacarpillary, all of them fuse at the center, and at the center you find the placenta giving rise to the seeds. So this sort of placentation, we call it as axile placentation. Here it is a tricarpillary fruit. You can notice that the septum of this tricarpillary fruit, they are fusing at the center to form the central axis. On this axis, you find the placenta. The ovules are attached to this axis by the placenta at the central axis formed by the fusion of the septum. So this sort of placentation, we call it as axile placentation. So best example that you might have noticed is the lady's finger. When you have taken for cutting the vegetable for before you make a curry, you might have seen that they have this 5 cavities, and at the axis, central axis formed by the fusion of septums, you find this axile placentation. That is, the ovules are attached to the ovary through the placenta. So we call it as axile placentation. The third type is the least nutritious fruit. So the parietal placentation, you notice in the least nutritious fruit. Does anyone know what is the least nutritious fruit? Or what this diagram represents? Where you have seen it? Anyone, you can switch on your mic and answer. Which is the least nutritious fruit? The least nutritious fruit is the cucumber. Cucumber is considered to be the least nutritious fruit. The most nutritious fruit is avocado. Okay, so the butterfruit, we call it as. So butterfruit milkshake you might have had. Anyway, the least nutritious fruit is cucumber. So it is a schematic representation. In cucumber, the ovules are attached to the ovary at the periphery. Through the placenta, they are attached to the ovary at the periphery. So we call it as parietal placentation. Parietal placentation, you can notice in cucumber as well as cucurbitaceae family, many members, they exhibit this parietal placentation. Then free central placentation. I don't know how many of you have observed this juice handu, we call it as passion fruit. Okay, it's a creeper. They have this fruit, passion fruit, we call it as. Inside, the pulp would be orangish and black seeds are there. Their aroma is quite good. It's not commercially very popular fruit, but many of them, they grow this and utilize this pulp for making juice, which is nothing but the passion fruit. Okay, so they have a free central placentation. That is, they have a central axis which is not formed by fusion of septum. That is why we call it as free central. So they have a central axis at which the ovules are attached to the central axis through the placenta. So we call this as free central placentation. You can notice this in this juice, hanno, or passion fruit. Okay, and this is also noticed in dianthus, the free central placentation. In basal placentation, the ovule is attached to the base of the ovary through the placenta. The ovule is attached by the placenta to the base of the ovary, so we call this as basal placentation. So placentation is the arrangement of ovules on the placenta within the ovary. So there are five types: marginal placentation, which you notice in case of Fabaceae, all the beans family, you can notice this marginal placentation, even in Batani, that is pea plant, or Aurecard. So Aurecard, you might have removed that outer peel of it. So they all exhibit this marginal placentation. Then axile placentation in lady's finger, you can notice that. That is pentacarpillary axile placentation. Axile placentation is by the fusion of these septum at the center, they form the axis. If the ovules are attached to the central axis through the placenta, we call it as axile placentation. In case of parietal placentation, which is noticed in cucumber, the least nutritious fruit, and in Cucurbitaceae family, so the ovules are attached to the periphery of the ovary walls by the placenta. So we call this as the parietal placentation, since the ovules are attached to the ovary wall at its periphery through the placenta, we call it as parietal placentation, characteristic feature of Cucurbitaceae family. Then in passion fruit or dianthus, you notice that the ovules are attached to the free central axis through the placenta, so we call it as free central placentation. So the central axis is not formed by the septum, fusion of septum. There is a central axis, and the ovules are attached to the central axis through the placenta. So we call this type of placentation as the free central placentation, which you can notice in the passion fruit or juice hanno, as well as in case of dianthus. Then basal placentation, the ovule is attached to the base of the ovary through the placenta. We call it as basal placentation. So now, one by one, we'll study about the different types of placentation. Marginal placentation, you found that here the placenta is going to form a ridge along the ventral suture, okay, of the ovary. See, whenever they are dry, this fruit, we call it as legume or pod. The legume or pod, whenever they are dry, they dehiscence at both the ends. You might have seen whenever you are trying to break a groundnut, it dehisces at both the ends. So this sort of dehiscence at both the longitudinal suture is a characteristic feature of this dry fruit, legume or pod. So here you have an example of the pea plant. So the pea fruit, you have this legume or fraud pod, we call it as. They dehisce at their ventral suture. So the placenta forms a ridge along the ventral suture of the ovary, and the ovules are born on the on this ridge. So on this ridge is the boundary of these two walls of the ovary. So on the ridge, the ovules are born on this ridge, and they form two rows. So you can notice here two rows of seeds, you can notice. So this is what we call it as the marginal placentation. Example, pea plant, they exhibit this marginal placentation. The axile placentation, so you can notice this in China rose, tomato, and lemon. Okay, so even in tomato, you can notice that the three of them, they are going to fuse the ventral sutures. It is tricarpillary in tomato. They are going to fuse here to form tricarpillary condition. And you find the seeds, ovules are attached to this axile through the placenta. So we call this as axile placentation. I told you more than this example. The best example is lady's finger, which exhibits this axile placentation, pentacarpillary, pentalocular axile placentation, which you notice in the lady's finger. Even China rose or hibiscus, if you take the ovary section, there also you find five carpels. And they have the central axis, and seeds are attached to this central axis. Ovules are attached to the central axis through the placenta. So we call it as axile placentation. So in case of axile placentation, the placenta is axial, and the ovules are attached to it in a multilocular ovary. So here it is tricarpary in tomato, as well as this iris luticans. Five locules, five carpels in case of the hibiscus as well as the lady's finger. Okay, so the placenta is axial and the ovules are attached to it in a multilocular ovary. I told you the sutures, they are all going to form a central axis. On the central axis, the ovules are attached to the placenta. So instead of saying all those terms, they have just said the placenta is axial and the ovules are attached to it in a multilocular ovary. Example is China rose, tomato, and lemon are example for this axile placentation. Now the next type of placentation is parietal placentation. Here the ovules develop on the inner wall of the ovary or on peripheral part. Here the ovules develop on the inner wall of the ovary or on peripheral part. So the ovules are attached to the inner walls of the ovary or on the periphery through the placenta. So we call it as parietal placentation. Okay. Ovary is one chambered. In case of mustard, they are talking about ovary is one chambered. Initially, it has only one chamber, but a false septum is formed in between them. So they become pseudo bicarpillary. Ovary is one chambered, but it becomes two chambered due to the formation of a false septum. Okay, due to the formation of a false septum, they become two chamber. So that false septum is called as replem. The false septum is called as replem. So that is noticed in case of mustard. So mustard also exhibits parietal placentation. So the parietal placentation, even this tondaikai, you can notice that. So where the ovules are attached to the peripheral walls of the ovary or the inner walls of the ovary through the placenta. So we call this type of arrangement as parietal placentation. Cucumber is also a very good example for that. Okay, so even though they are tricarpillary in cucumber, they are unilocular. That is, they don't have septum to divide them into locules. So even though they are tricarpillary, they are unilocular. So they have this gelatinous substance, gel-like substance, through within which you find the seeds, even in case of the cucumber. Okay, so parietal placentation, even in tondaikai, you can notice this parietal placentation. So the example for this parietal placentation is the mustard and Argemone. Argemone mexicana is going to be a poisonous plant. Even this video on Argemone mexicana, I have uploaded it in the biology trivia. So you can just watch this mustard and Argemone Mexicana. See, the seeds from this Argemone plant, they are used to adulterate the mustard oil. They are the seeds from this Argemone, they are used to adulterate the mustard oil. So they cause a droopsy effect on them. So they use this Argemone seeds to adulterate the mustard oil. So remember about this droopsy effect that is caused by this Argemone Mexicana. Okay. The next type is the free central placentation. In this free central placentation, there is a central axis. On this central axis, surrounding them, you find this ovules are attached to the through the placenta on the central axis. This central axis is not formed by the cross wall. This you can notice. So here, ovules are born on central axis and septa are absent. when I'm talking about cross vowels, the septa are absent. So example is dianthus, passion fruit, that is the juice hanu, primrose. They're all examples for free central placentation. So whenever they ask this concept for 5-mark question, so you have to draw this simple diagram and give the explanation. Okay. The basal placentation, here the placenta develops at the base of the ovary and a single ovule is attached to it. Here the placenta develops at the base of the ovary and a single ovule is attached to it. Example, sunflower, suryakanti, okay, marigold, that is chenduvuva. So you find the ovules are attached to the ovary at the base of the ovary, the placenta, the ovule is attached to the base of the ovary through the placenta. So we call it as basal placentation. I also have one more example for this, that is 4 o'clock plant. So the Sanjeevuva, we call it as, they bloom in the evening time. This is also commonly seen. Some of them grow it also as an ornamental plant. Some of them, you also find them growing wildly. So I have a video for this 4 o'clock plant also, you can notice. Even there, when you break up the fruit part of it, you find a single seed, which almost looks like the pepper-like seed, which is attached to the base of the ovary. So that is also an example for basal placentation. Sunflower is an example for basal placentation. Marigold is also an example for the basal placentation. Here the placenta develops at the base of the ovary and a single ovule is attached to the placenta. Such type of placentation we call it as